Aren't you glad you got a God like that? You got your Bibles.
Oh,
you ought to.
I'd be wrong if I didn't. Just bear with me for a minute. I don't know how I'm going to get through it all, but I want to tell y'all a story about this little boy who his mommy and daddy was fighting all the time and on drugs. And when he was 4 years old, daddy left and they got divorced. About time he was nine, a neighbor invited the family to church. And, you know, the mom started taking him and his little brother, but not daddy. You know, he was off doing his own thing. And that little boy got saved when he was 11.
Amen.
And from the time that he was 11, he was praying that God would save his daddy. And, well, that boy's now a 36-year-old man, and he's me. And Friday night, I was at a revival at my brother's church out at Finch.
Amen.
And God saved my daddy.
Amen.
Yeah, man.
I only want to tell y'all that because that was 25 years worth of praying.
Yeah.
And I'd be a liar if I didn't say at times that I wouldn't even pray about it anymore because I just started doubting if it ever happened. But we have a promise in the Word of God, Pastor John.
Yeah.
That if we pray in the will of God for something,
yeah,
He's going to answer that prayer.
Amen.
Yeah.
And it's His will that none should perish, but all come to repentance.
Yeah.
So I just want to encourage everybody today, if you're praying for someone to get saved, and maybe it's been 25 or more years, don't give up on him. Don't give up on that person.
Yeah.
God is going to answer sometime, somehow, some way. I never would have believed it. It took me a day or two to really sink in. And I want to leave you with this, is I think that Pastor John, Friday night taught me something that, you know, when people come to the altar and get saved, or you say, hey, so-and-so got saved at the truck stop or in front line or at the juvenile center, or, you know, a missionary was preaching overseas and, you know, some got saved. You know, sometimes I think we just take that for granted and
we don't really
realize the miracle of miracles that really is.
Yeah.
But when my dad got saved, it really hit me, because to me that was more impossible than anything on earth. I mean, if you only knew this person, but if God can do that, He can do anything.
Yeah.
Because see, when someone comes and kneels at the altar, all we do is physically see them coming to the altar, praying, crying, giving some hugs, and going back. But we don't see what's happening that we can't see.
Mm-hmm.
We don't see that they had all these things written against them, and in that moment they got a full pardon, and none of those things are no longer on the record. We don't see in heaven God taking a pen and writing their name in the Lamb's Book of Life. We don't see the facial expression.
I wish I could have
saw the face of Satan in that moment, as he was just so mad that he had lost another one. I mean, just if we only knew what was going on in that moment.
Yeah.
I thank God for saving my dad.
Yeah.
He's a good God. Yeah. It's something. It gave me personal revival like I've never had before.
Yeah.
I haven't really been everything I should be lately. But if God can save my dad, He just showed me there ain't no reason why I can't live for Him to the fullest every single day. He can do anything.
Yeah.
He can do exceedingly abundantly above all we ask or think. And I just praise Him this morning.
Amen. Well, that's good. If you got your Bibles, turn to 1 Chronicles 12 and 23. Chad's going to come up and read a lengthy section. Today I come do what I've done, Lois, for 42 years. I came to church before everybody was here, unlocked the doors, turned all the lights on, turned off the alarm, walked down to this altar, prayed for every one of you that I thought would be here, asked the Lord to help me to do one thing that I've been trying to do for 42 years here. Lord, I said, I want to, this morning, one more time, to elevate Jesus. I really don't care what's going on in the world. There's only one cure for this world.
Amen.
And that's to put Jesus on the throne of your life. And I prayed a little longer this morning. long enough till God brought tears to my eyes, long enough that I could wet the altar. I prayed for everybody in the church. But I said, Jesus, I want to adore you a minute. Been doing it for 42 years. I'm not flawless, but I want you to know I love him. And I love being your pastor. And this morning I'm going to preach a message entitled, Elevating Jesus. But see, it takes more than a pastor to elevate Jesus. It takes more than a deacon board to elevate Jesus. I think every born again, blood washed child of God ought to elevate Jesus.
Amen.
Chad, you come and read, and I'll come and preach.
First Chronicles chapter 12, starting in verse 23. If you're there, say amen.
Amen.
And these are the numbers of the bands that were ready armed to the war and came to David to Hebron to turn the kingdom of Saul to him according to the word of the Lord. The children of Judah that bear shield and spear were 6,800, ready armed to the war. Of the children of Simeon, mighty men of valor for the war, 7,100. Of the children of Levi, 4,600. And Jehoiada was the leader of the Aaronites, and with him were 3,700. And Zadok, a young man mighty of valor, and of his father's house, 22 captains. And of the children of Benjamin, the kindred of Saul, 3,000. For hitherto, the greatest part of them had kept the ward of the house of Saul. And the children of Ephraim, 20,800, mighty men of valor, famous throughout the house of their fathers. And of the half tribe of Manasseh, 18,000, which were expressed by name, to come and make David king. And of the children of Issachar, which were men that had understanding of the times, to know what Israel ought to do, the heads of them were 200, and all their brethren were at their commandment. Of Zebulun, such as went forth to battle, expert in war with all instruments of war, 50,000, which could keep rank. They were not of double heart. And of Naphtali, 1,000 captains, and with them, with shield and spear, 37,000. And of the Danites, expert in war, 28,600. And of Asher, such as went forth to battle, expert in war, 40,000. And on the other side of Jordan, of the Reubenites and the Gadites, and of the half tribe of Manasseh, with all manner of instruments of war for the battle, 120,000. All these men of war that could keep rank came with a perfect heart to Hebron to make David king over all Israel, and all the rest also of Israel were of one heart to make David king. And there they were with David 3 days, eating and drinking, for their brethren had prepared for them. Moreover, they that were nigh them, even unto Issachar and Zebulun and Naphtali, brought bread on asses and on camels and on mules and on oxen and meat, meal, cakes of figs and bunches of raisins, and wine and oil and oxen and sheep abundantly. For there was joy in Israel.
Thank you, Chad. That's an awesome passage, isn't it? I want you to listen to God's word this morning. Saul was the first king of Israel. He looked good on the outside. He started well, but he ended bad.
You're right,
preacher. I guess one of the saddest things about preaching the church for 42 years, you do see people that came and have come, started well, but they ended bad. There's always folks like that. Then God rose up a man. The Bible said this, that he was after God's own heart. He was a giant slayer. He's known as the sweet psalmist of Israel. Saul tried to kill him several times. And David had an opportunity to kill Saul. in that cave, but David didn't. He just kind of took a knife and took a little piece off of Saul and said that the reason he didn't do it, he didn't want to lay his hand on God's anointed. By the way, it would be a good idea that you don't lay your hand on God's people and God's man and God's preacher. Somebody help me preach. David was king of the south over Judah. Ishbosheth was king over the 10 northern tribes of Israel. Ishbosheth was Saul's son. He was wicked. He was ungodly. He would emulate some of those that are trying to run for office right now. Wicked, ungodly, unfit. Amen. And God let him, he died. And then what happened? Those in the north talked to those in the south, and they agreed that they wanted to make David, to exalt David as king. They wanted to come together. They wanted to end their division. I want you to know America this morning is a divided nation. We got a lot of, even up fundamental Baptists don't even like each other. Somebody help me preach right there. By the way, you might not dot your I like me and cross your T exactly the way I do, and you may not even pastor a church the way I do, but if we could just give our allegiance to Jesus and lift up Jesus and come under the banner of the cross of Jesus, we still could make a difference in this nation if the church of the living God would come together. Somebody help me preach and give our allegiance to Jesus. Because, see, he's the only king. I'm celebrating 42 years, but I want you to know I'm not the king of Taze Valley. There's just one king of this church, and his name Jesus. It's not the pastor. It's not the associates. It's not a deacon board. It's not a trustee board. No, no, no. We need to give our allegiance to Jesus. Amen. This society is going to hell in a handbasket. We've given way to hip hop, Hollywood, socialism, anarchy. And here at Taze Valley, we need to pledge this morning allegiance to Jesus. As they came together and pledged allegiance to David, who was a picture of Jesus, we need to be in one army, one group, sold out to the cause of lifting up Jesus, not lifting up Baptist name, not lifting up some denomination, but lifting up Jesus.
Amen. Amen, preacher.
Amen. This world deserves better than that. This world deserves one thing from God's people, and that is to elevate Jesus. So, for the next few moments, I want to show you the kind of people that elevate Jesus. Somebody help me preach. Amen. An army. See, here's what, you know, this pandemic, and I'm not talking about people with underlying conditions. I'm talking about people that's got lazy now. They're not a part of the army right now. Yes, we all had to shut in for a while. But can I talk to you on live stream? Why don't you come back and be a part of God's army? I know you love him. Don't let a little virus keep you from serving a great king. Somebody help me preach. Somewhere along the line, he ought to be more important than anything in our life. He's the one that saved you. He's the one that brought you from your hell. He's the one that washed you in his blood. He's the one that sealed you by his spirit. He's the one that justified you, is sanctifying you, and is going to glorify you.
That's a good preaching.
Amen. Let me show you the kind of army we need. Look at verse 2. The Bible said they were armed with bows and could use both their right hand and the left hand. They were skilled. Somebody help me preach. They could use both hands. Those hands were prepared. Those hands were persistent. You said, what were those hands doing? They were handling the bow. I want to tell you what, we don't have a bow and we don't have a sword, but we do have a word of God. We ought to be skilled in the word of God. Can I tell you something? This bothers me a little bit. There's more access to more tools to understand the Bible than there's ever been. And there's more ignorance about God's word than there's ever been. Explain it. I'll tell you why. You want to know why people hop out of church and hop into the world? Because they're not skilled. See, I've got to be able to use this in both hands. Somebody help me preach. I'm talking about somebody help me. You know why a lot of people fall away from God? It's because they're not skilled in the Bible. You say, why haven't you quit? Have you? It's just because you've had it easy as pastor. I haven't had it easy. It's been a battle ever since I've been here. I didn't even get a long honeymoon when I started pastoring here. Had a fight after 6 months. Hello. Remember, Paul, you ought to remember when we tried to build that activity building. All hell broke loose. But you said, how'd you survive? Or how have you survived? Because I'm skillful in the word of God. I know the word of God's my hope. I know the word of God is inerrant. I know the word of God is infallible. I know, wow, glory. That's the kind of army we need. We need an army of people that's skilled in the Bible, that wants to read the word of God, that wants to handle the word of God. And they're not out here picking one place that they live and one place they don't live. Now listen, the whole Bible is for us to live. Amen. Amen. All it is. Verse number 8, there also were separated men. And of the Gadites, separated themselves. Somewhere along the line, you said, well, God saved me, that's separate. No, you need to separate yourself. I know preachers, they social drink, yours don't. I know preachers, they smoke, yours don't. I know preachers that are in pornography, yours don't. I know preachers that are living like little hound dogs. Yours don't. I want you to know we need to be separated, and we separate ourselves. But that's not just for the preacher. That's for every child of God. Everybody in this church ought to separate yourself, be holy, and lift up Jesus. It's not for the preacher. It's for you. Amen. They were set apart. If you read the scripture, they were serious. They had faces like lions. They were swift. They moved like deer. They were special. They could handle, one man could handle 1,000. Here's what's sad. In modern Christianity, we're seeing people topple, going from marriage to marriage. Come on, help me. Church to church, falling away. You say, what's happening, preacher? Because see, you can't handle yourself, must have to handle 1,000. See, what we need some people that are skillful and separated, that are special, that can handle 1,000, that there's not a problem the devil throws at them that Jesus can't conquer. So all we got to do is Anthony Smith, elevate him to the throne. All we got to do, Stan Souter, is elevate him to the throne. If we can just get him up where he needs to be. Amen. See, if we're going to get an army, God's army can't look like the devil's army. And God's army can't act like the devil's army. We're in a battle. Hey, the lines are drawn. They're changing the gender lines. They're redefining marriage. Anarchy is in the street. We need some people to separate themselves from God. Verse 16 and 18, they were servants. And there came of the children of Benjamin and Judah to hold unto David. Verse 18, then the spirit came unto Amaliah, the chief of the captains, and said, thine are we, David. Somebody help me preach. They were loyal in their support. See, I see people, they're loyal until you cross over their boundary. As long as you keep them happy, they're loyal. As long as you pet their little, just pet them a little bit, they're loyal. But these men, listen to me, weren't like that. They didn't need to be petted. They didn't need to be reassured every day. They didn't need to be coddled. They were army. They were men. They stood for God. Somebody help me. In this time of easy religion, in this time of softness, in this time of anarchy, we need some people that will stand and be separated and stand out for God. Amen. They love their service. Come on, help me. The choir ought to be singing because they love Jesus. We ought to have people giving because they love Jesus. You know what you ought to be saying in your heart? I'm going to be everything God wants me to do because I believe in you. Here's the point. You're not going to be faithful to anybody you don't believe in. I ain't talking about just being saved. I believe in him. You believe in God? Believe also in me. And by the way, I belong to him. When he brought me out of that pit, January 31st, 1973, I was belonged to the devil, then I belonged to God. I still belong to him. And I tell you what, if you believe in him and you belong to him, you'll behave for him. Why is it that I, as a pastor, have to deal with subjects like this? Social drinking? Pornography? Cheating on your spouse? Why do I have to do that? I'll tell you why. Because a lot of people still don't believe in him, though they've been saved, and they don't feel like they belong to him, and they don't behave right. Somebody help me preach. We need to be a people, God. I'm not a perfect man. I know that. There's some of you probably can point my faults out. There's some of you probably can tell some bad decision I made. Surely you can. Surely I can. But I want you to know that works both ways, Jack. I want you to know you ain't perfect either. But we're not elevating John Smith. I'm not elevating a deacon. I'm elevating a Christ who's never failed, who's got the keys of death, hell, and the grave, who's on the throne. Somebody help me. So they were servants. I want to tell you, here's what's missing. And I'm going to say this. I know people that are laboring with us here at the church. They're laborers. And they labor. But the first time they don't like something, they quit. They're the first one to gripe, the first one to fuss. Boy, I think I'm preaching. Somebody help me. See, here's the difference between a laborer and a servant. A servant, ain't nothing matters. You're not going to fall out. See, most of the people I fell out over, it's all personal. They get a personal thing they don't like about the church, or a personal thing they don't like about you. You know what I'm talking about, but I want you to know something. We ought to put our personality and our stuff aside, and nothing matters but lifting up Jesus. Nothing matters but elevating Jesus. You said, why does your staff love you so much? Because I love them and I elevate Jesus and try to care for them. Somebody help me preach. Tell you one other thing else they were sensible. You know what? I don't know if you've ever experienced this. Have you ever just talked to people and they just ain't sensible? I mean, just not sensible. I mean, hold it. Just not sensible. I don't care how big a case you plead, they're not sensible. Look what it said in verse 32. These people understood the times. They were sensible. They were tuned in. Hey, sometimes I wonder if people's tuned in. Hello? See, I wonder if they know what's going on. See, we need to be sensible parents. Somebody say amen. Hey, single person, you need to be a single person that is sensible. And let God bring the right person in your life. Amen. By the way, I still believe that we need to teach boys to be boys. Amen. And girls to be girls. And we do need to tell them there is a difference in their gender. And by the way, and some of you families need to check their phone too. See, because the devil's a liar, he's a lion, and he's going to lose, and somebody got to be sensible. Somebody help me preach. This world's going to hell. How many agree with me? Did you see what went on in Wisconsin this week? Did you see what happened again out in Minnesota and Missouri and other places this week? Have you seen it? See, the media tells you one story. And this one, you know what? Some of our people haven't made it back to church. They're listening to the media more than they are listening to the man of God. Media scared them to death. By the way, we're sensible. I'll tell you how we've handled this pandemic. You're in a mask. We're taking care of that. Amen. And if you've been around somebody that had the virus and there's a likelihood you could get it, stay home for 14 days. And if we suspect that it might get into the church, we'll shut down a week or two. But we ain't quitting. We ain't stopping. Because we're sensible. The whole world's went crazy. But don't let us go crazy. We need to be an army that wants to elevate Jesus and just be sensible. Oh, I've had challenges. And most of them are people that are not sensible, that had an agenda, and maybe family meant more to than the cause of Christ. Listen to me, we need to be sensible. Look at verse 33 and 38. I'm trying to hurry. Whoo, glory. Now notice this. Of Zebulun, such as went forth to battle, expert in war, with all instruments of war, 50,000 could keep what? Rank. And they were not of a double what? Heart. Woo. They were sincere people. Oh, look at verse 38. And all these men of war could keep rank, came with a perfect heart to Hebron. They knew who the king was. Somebody help me. They were undefiled by hypocrisy. You can't be a phony and be in God's army. Somebody help me preach. This church is not full. We didn't come here this morning to entertain. We didn't come here to be entertained. We come here to raise up Jesus. Oh. You can't go out on a party on Saturday night and come out on Sunday and praise. You can't cuss and shout at the same time. had a lady call me a few years ago about her husband that went to church here. And by the way, your wife knows you better than anybody else. She said, I know you think my husband is a superman. He's a hypocrite. I said, why? She said, on Saturday night, he goes out and drinks and parties, and then he'll come out and put his suit and tie on Sunday, and it's a phony. And then finally got saved. Somebody help me preach. By the way, you don't need to be no phony this morning. And they were upheld by unity. They kept your rank. Soldiers, not generals. Hey, there's one Christ. By the way, there's one pastor. Hello, we got associates. There's one pastor. Let me tell you something. You need to learn to keep rank. If we're going to be an army for God, we got to be loyal. We got to keep rank. Amen. Every service, every song, every testimony, somebody help me and lift up your hands if you believe it, ought to lift up Jesus. Amen. But oh, I'm not done. Look at verse 38. I'm almost finished. They were sacrificial. 39 and 40. They're going to have a party, Brother Chad. And by the way, they were going to bring something to the party. How many's ever went to a party or invited to a party and those people came to the party but didn't bring nothing? Quiet in here. But they came and ate and they filled themselves, but they didn't bring nothing. Not these boys. Look at it. In verse number 40, look at it. Moreover, that were nigh them, even unto Issachar and Zebulun and Naphtali, they brought bread on asses and camels and mules and oxen and meat and meal and cakes of figs and bunches of raisins and wine and oil and oxen and sheep abundantly. Somebody help me preach. They were selfless and they were substantial. They brought their money. Why is it there's people in God's work and God's church don't even pay their tithe? You want the party. You want to be in the blessing. But you won't bring nothing. By the way, you need to be substantial. By the way, my staff knows what I give because they count it every week. And I try to be substantial. I try to give myself. By the way, you'll never be able to give money until you give yourself and be selfless. We having a party here. We lifting up Jesus. So we need to bring something to the party. Amen. Oh, man. What are you bringing to the party? You bringing negativism? Bringing a critical spirit? That ain't what they done. Amen. They came to the party and brought something. I want to tell you something. I saved 47 years ago. Back here on the back, he's here this morning, Bill Lamont. He's the reason I got saved. I asked Bill, the pastor got up one day, and I asked Bill, I said, he mentioned giving a tithe. I said, I don't have a clue what he meant. And Bill looked at me, he said, what that means is, he says, how much you make a month? And I said, $350. He said, that means you get 35 to God. I said, is that it? And he thought, I don't know if he thought it was going to upset me. I said, is that all? I never give 10%. I've always given more. Because, see, I'm coming to the party. I've been invited to the party. So I'll give my tithe, plus I'll give my mission offering, plus I'll give to the building, plus somebody help me. I want it to be substantial. Because, see, it ain't for me. It's for the King. If some of you got your pocketbook saved this morning, what a day we'd have. Good preaching, Reverend. And lastly, and I'm done. I got to hurry. This I really want to, I want to magnify. They were satisfied. Look what it said in the last phrase. For there was joy in Israel. My wife told me if I didn't do this, she's going to kill me. Now I'm going to tell you, Kerrigan, what I see in the Baptist churches, a lot of people that are not satisfied. They satisfy as long as they are petted. Long as you recognize me. Long as I'm pointed out. There's a lot of people maybe here this morning, this by the way of live stream. There's no joy in your life. You ever ask why there's no joy? Why is it so bad? I know. Teacher, I know the answer. We're not elevating Jesus. He's not on the throne. I'm going to say this. He needs to be more important to you than she is. You just got a new baby, didn't you? Jesus needs to be more important to you than that new baby. But if he is, that baby will have the best.
Amen.
Somebody help me preach. You know what I see? I see a generation of people today with no joy. Why can't you have a happy home and a joyful home? You can if you lift Jesus up. I wonder how many of you this morning would join at the altar and say, you know, I want to be a part of that army. I don't need to be a general. I don't need to be in charge. I'm just glad to be there. When I got on my knees this morning, and then I sat at the altar for a little while. And I just sat here. I said, boy, it's so good to be saved. And Lord, you let me pastor a great church. I was overwhelmed with joy. Well, I'm overwhelmed right now. I don't have to serve Jesus. I get to serve Jesus. I'm not going to hell now. I'm going to heaven now. Woo! I'll tell you what I think some of the problem is. You've got over it. You've got over it. You've got over it. You got over what happened to you. I ain't. It's still fresh. I remember being a bartender's boy. I remember being on my way to hell. I remember a mama praying for me every day. But thank God that Jesus passed by. Amen. For the next 47 years, I've been just trying to do one thing. Lift him up. Amen. Lift him up. And by the way, if we lift him up, sinners are going to see it.
Amen.
If you're here lost today, you know what your big problem in life is? You don't have no joy. You're on the way to a devil's hell. There's no hope for you. You're going to be in hell and burn forever and ever and ever. And it doesn't have to be that way because God wants to save you.
Amen.
Bow your head with me. Thank you for being so patient with me. How many of you know you're saved? Raise them high. If you know for sure, if you don't know, don't raise them. Thank you. How many Christians in this room say, preacher, I don't have the joy I should have. I'm saved, but I don't have that joy I should have. Raise your hand if you don't have the joy you should have as a Christian. Raise it up. God bless you. Raise up. God bless you. How many right now, whether you're a young person, mom or dad, would raise your hand and say, I don't want to go to hell. I want to know when I die, I'm going to heaven. I want you to pray for me, preacher. Would you raise your hand if you couldn't raise your hand? Say, I'm not a Christian. I'm a young person without Christ. Slip your hand up if you want to be saved before you die, before the Lord comes. Come on, slip it up. God bless that hand. Somebody else. Come on, young lady, young man, just slip it up. Say, I'm not saved. I want to be. I want to be. Come on, come on, come on. I'm going to pray for you. Father, as our people are standing to their feet, God, just help some of them that you've been so good to. Come to the altar this morning and just elevate you. Just lift up you. Just care for you. Just say, you're the most important thing in my life. Above everything. God, would you help people? In Jesus' name. Amen. Are you going to find a place?